So this is chapter 10, infinite sequences and series. In this chapter, you will learn about infinite sequences and series, but before that, let me remind you that you have already seen some useful infinite sequences and series. A comma A plus D comma A plus 2D and so on. What is the nth term in this? A plus N minus 1D. What is this? Arithmetic progression. It is arithmetic progression. Likewise, A comma AR comma AR square and so on. AR power N minus 1. You recall it? It's geometric progression. This is AP. This is GP. These are infinite sequences. What is sum of this GP? First sum of first n terms. A plus AR plus and so on. AR power n minus 1. What is this sum? A times 1 minus R power n over 1 minus R. As n tends to infinity, this goes to a over 1 minus r. Under this condition, mod r should be less than 1. This goes to this as n tends to infinity. This is sum of infinite GP. Means a plus ar square and so on. This is in fact geometric series. Its sum is a over 1 minus r provided mod r is less than 1. You can write it in the compact form also, summation n varying from 1 to infinity a r power n minus 1. A r power n minus 1. This is geometric series. This is geometric progression or geometric sequence. This is arithmetic progression or arithmetic sequence. Okay, so already you are familiar with this infinite sequences and series. Now, the purpose of this chapter is to learn infinite sequences and series in general. I mean, if you are given any series, summation an. Now an can have any formula. In this particular case, an has the formula ar power n minus 1. What if it is any formula in n? Then how to find its sum or how to see its behavior? Okay. So that is the main purpose. But before learning infinite series, you need to learn about infinite sequences. So let's begin with infinite sequences. What is a sequence, first of all, or infinite sequence? If you have a function with domain as the set of natural numbers, then successive values of this function f1, f2 and so on give you infinite sequence. Here n is a natural number, 1, 2, 3 and so on. Means any formula in n, say I write n square, fn equal to n square. So what are its successive values? If I put n equal to 1, 2, 3 and so on, 1 square, 2 square and so on. So this is a sequence. So how you obtain a sequence? It is obtained by successive values of a function with domain as the set of natural numbers. There is a shortcut notation for it. Instead of writing brackets, we use another symbol an. Okay, so an is basically a function with domain as the set of natural numbers. Okay. Also, we denote this whole expression using curly brackets. You just write nth term here of the sequence and put curly bracket. This denotes this whole expression. 1 square means in this particular example, 1 square, 2 square and so on. Okay, so that means if an is any sequence, then its terms are a1, a2 and so on. Next point, you understand sequence. How we see whether a sequence is convergent or divergent means the meaning of convergent and divergent sequences. A sequence an is said to be convergent if limit of its nth term is a finite number, say L. So I say that an tends to L as n tends to infinity. So limit of nth term goes to a finite number L as n tends to infinity. In that case, we say that the sequence an converges to L, is convergent to L. You can write like this. If limit of the nth term goes to L as n tends to infinity. What does it mean? More technically, you can say that using the concept of limit, whatever neighborhood of L I choose, given any epsilon positive, means I choose any neighborhood of L, then there exists some positive integer m such that for all n greater than m, mod of an minus L is less than epsilon. Okay, for all n greater than m. Or you can write it an belongs to L minus epsilon to L plus epsilon for all n greater than m. Means all members of the sequence lie in this interval, in this neighborhood of L. Only finite members of the sequence can stay outside. So if here is L, then whatever neighborhood you choose for L, L minus epsilon to L plus epsilon, all members of the sequence lie in this interval. Only finite can stay outside, depending on the choice of epsilon. Okay, let's see one example. Suppose I consider this sequence 1 over n. What is the limit of this? Limit of an or 1 over n is 0. See what's going on around 0. If you consider various members of the sequence, first member is 1, then 1 by 2, then 1 by 3 and so on. So whatever neighborhood of 0 I choose, this carries all the members of the sequence. Only finite number of members can stay outside. Is it clear or not? How many members will stay outside? That depends on the size of your neighborhood. So it's just the concept of limit, okay? Why do we say it converges to this? Because all members of the sequence are coming closer and closer to zero as n tends to infinity, clustering near zero in the limit an goes to zero in this example. So it is converging to this. As n increases, the members of the sequence become closer and closer to zero. That's the meaning of convergence. What if I choose an equal to n square? What do you say in this case? Is it convergent? No. You see what is happening. The members are 1 square, then 2 square means 4, then next 9, like that. So can you find a finite number around which the members are becoming closer and closer? No. In fact, limit of this goes to infinity as n tends to infinity. So this sequence is not convergent, it is divergent. See this example also. Minus 1 power n over n. What can you say about its behavior? Convergent or divergent? Converges to 0, clearly as n tends to infinity. But it's good to see how the members are lying around 0. First member is minus 1, second. If you put n equal to 1, this is minus 1, second. 1 by 2, no, minus 1 is this side. Second is 1 by 2, say it is here. Then minus 1 by 3, plus 1 by 4. Like that, it continues. So finite number of members can stay outside, either to the left or to the right, to any, in any chosen neighborhood, all the members of the sequence are lying. Isn't it? Except finite can stay outside. So it is a kind of oscillating behavior, but in the limit, it is going to zero. So this sequence is convergent to zero. So I hope you understand the meaning of convergent sequence and divergent sequence. Just consider the nth term of the sequence C. If it is converging to a finite number, say L, then you say the sequence converges to L. Otherwise, it's divergent. Okay. Now, it is all about finding the limit of nth term, right? I think you are good at finding limits involving infinity. Let's take one example. Suppose I want to find the behavior of the sequence n plus 1 over n square plus n plus 5. This sequence converges or diverges? How do you find it? Converges or diverges? You need its limit. Limit n tending to infinity, n plus 1 over n square plus n plus 5. So limit n tends to infinity, how can you write it? 1 over n, 1 plus 1 over n. I have multiplied and divided by, not multiplied, I divided numerator and denominator by n square. So it is 1 plus 1 over n plus 5 over n square. Now this goes to 1 plus 0, 1 plus 0 plus 0, and 1 over n, n goes to infinity, 0 into finite goes to 0. So this sequence converges to 0. Okay. You could also apply L'Hopital rule if you don't want to do this kind of adjustment. What is that? L'Hopital rule. I think you are familiar with it. If you are not familiar, see it. It is very helpful, especially when you have infinity over infinity form or zero over zero form. Both these forms are same. These situations, we can apply L'Hopital rule. What is it? say you have x going to a fx over gx, and when you apply the limit, you are getting infinity over infinity. This goes to infinity, this also goes to infinity. Or this goes to zero, this also goes to zero. So the rule says that differentiate numerator and denominator with respect to x, then try the limit. Okay. See this famous example. If you are interested in finding limit of sin x over x, then because it is 0 over 0 form, sin 0 is 0, 0 over 0 form. So applying LHopital rule, what can you say? Cos x over 1, differentiate numerator as well as denominator with respect to x. Now you can apply the limit and get the answer 1. Okay, so this is very useful rule. By the way, why does it work? Means why do you get this thing? You understand? Say when you apply x going to a, you are getting 0 over 0. That means fa is 0, ga is also 0 when you apply this limit. So if I subtract fa, doesn't make any difference. Subtract ga here, doesn't make any difference. Divide numerator as well as denominator by x minus a, it doesn't make any difference. But what is the limit of numerator now? It's a prime a. It is at prime a. The limit x going to a fx minus fa over x minus a is derivative of f at a. So it's the same thing when you apply the limit, okay? Same going denominator. So you understand how LHopital rule works. So in this case, if you want to apply LHopital rule, what can you say? Because it is infinity over infinity form, you can see clearly. So differentiate numerator and denominator with respect to n. What do you get? 1 over 2n plus 1. Now you can clearly understand it is 1 over infinity goes to 0. LHopital rule works in many problems, so you should know it. If you are given n equal to ln over n, ln n over n, you want to see the behavior of the sequence. So what to do? In this case, LHopital rule will help you, because as n tends to infinity, it is infinity over infinity form. Ln infinity is infinity, right? So what can I write in this particular example? Ln derivative with respect to n is 1 over n. Derivative of n is 1. So it goes to 0. So this sequence, you can say, converges to 0. Okay. So you should be good at finding limits involving infinity. Then there is no problem in testing the behavior of an infinite sequence. You can easily do it. Okay, now what is a bounded sequence? Let's learn some more properties of sequences. And what is bounded above, bounded below? Bounded above means if you can find a real number, K such that, capital K such that, all numbers of the sequence are less than equal to capital K, then it is bounded above. Bounded below means you can find a real number, say small k, such that all members of the sequence AM are greater than equal to K. This is bounded below, this is bounded above, and what is bounded sequence? If all the members of the sequence lie in a finite interval. So bounded below as well as bounded above. See this sequence. Is it bounded above or bounded below or bounded? What are its members? Its members are 1, 1 by 2, and so on, going to 0. So all members lie in which interval? 1 to 0. 0 is of course not a member of the sequence, but I can say that all members are not 1 to 0, 0 to 1. You should write interval. All members are less than or equal to 1. And all members are greater than 0. So it is bounded sequence. If I write this sequence, bounded below, but not bounded above. It is not bounded above, that means the sequence is not bounded. Okay. So you understand bounded sequence. Now let us see what is a monotonic sequence. Monotonic sequence. A sequence with the property either an less than or equal to an plus 1 or an greater than or equal to an plus 1 for all n. It means it is decreasing. It means it is. No. An less than or equal to an plus 1 means what? A1 less than or equal to A2 less than or equal to A3 and so on. And an greater than or equal to n plus 1 means a1 greater than or equal to a2 greater than or equal to a3 and so on. So this is increasing sequence, this is decreasing. A monotonous behavior is there. Correct? See this sequence. It is increasing or decreasing? 1, 2, 3 and so on. Increasing. And this sequence 1, 1 by 2, 1 by 3 and so on. You understand? It's decreasing. So these are monotonic sequences. In monotonic sequences, you can remember the result that a monotonic sequence, say it is monotonically increasing and it is bounded above, then it is always convergent. Monotonically decreasing sequence bounded below is also always convergent. But at least you should know what is monotonic sequence. A sequence with monotonous behavior. Okay. So with these results from sequences, let's move to the main topic, that is of infinite series. Infinite series. If an is any sequence, see the definition, if an is any sequence, then the expression a1 plus a2 and so on is called infinite series. I can write it in compact form, means summation form. This is an infinite series. So infinite series is constructed from an infinite sequence. Okay. So if I don't write n 1 to infinity, it's understood that n goes from 1 to infinity here, okay, in further discussion. Now, our main interest is to understand the behavior of this infinite series. You know that the geometric series, for example, the geometric series sum is a over 1 minus r for mod r less than 1. Okay, so how do we find it? How do we find that sum of this infinite series is this? In general, this is for geometric series, you know, but how can we do it for any infinite series? Okay, let us consider an infinite series summation n varying from 1 to infinity an. Then define a sequence called sequence of partial sums. That is nothing but sum of its first n terms. It is sequence of partial sums. Now think carefully. What happens if I make n going to infinity in Sn? What is right hand side? The whole series, a1 plus a2 and so on. That is nothing but the given series. What does it mean? If I know the behavior of Sn, I know the behavior of summation n. So, behavior of summation n is same as behavior of the sequence of partial sums. You can see clearly here. And also limit of Sn is nothing but sum of the series. So to find the behavior of this infinite series, what do you need to do? Find Sn and then take the limit of Sn. If that limit is finite, means Sn is convergent, say, then summation n is also convergent. If Sn is not convergent, this is also not convergent. So behavior of infinite series depends totally on the behavior of Sn. Let's see a problem. Suppose we are given this infinite series, summation n varying from 1 to infinity, 1 over 2 power n. What is Sn in this case? You will write 1 over 2 plus 1 over 2 square plus and so on 1 over 2 power n. Sum of first n terms. Now, can we find the limit of Sn as n tends to infinity? Before that, you need to know the formula for its sum in terms of n so that you can find the limit. What is the sum of this? Sum of n terms. In fact, it is Gp, you already know it. A into 1 minus r power n over 1 minus r. It goes to 1 over 2 into 1 minus 0 over 1 over 2 means 1 as n tends to infinity. Am I right? Yes, it means Sn is convergent because its limit is finite. So this series is also convergent and sum of this series is 1. Is it okay? Yes, so you have to find Sn. Now, see this example. Summation only n is given to you here. Let's see the behavior of this series. It is 1 plus 2 and so on in this case. Sequence of partial sums is this. What is its sum? You know the formula for this also. N into n plus 1 by 2. It goes to infinity. As n tends to infinity. So what can you say about the behavior of this series? This is divergent because its sequence of partial sums is divergent. All right. What if I give you this series? This case, Sn is 1 plus 1 by 2 plus 1 by 3 and so on. Up to 1 over n. Can you write a formula for this? Can you do the summation in terms of n? No, you cannot do it. It means this as an approach will not work. Okay, you have to devise some other tests for convergence. Before going to the test, I want to ask you something. Suppose this series is converging to 1. Okay. This is not suppose, it is converging to 1. What if I remove first two terms, or let's say first term only? Will it change its behavior? Means I write here true power, or let me write it fully. You are given this series 1 by 2 square, 1 by 2 cube, and so on. I'm saying that if I remove first finite number of terms, will it change the behavior of the series? No. Earlier, this series is converging to 1. After removing these, this converges to 1 minus 1 by 2 minus 1 by 2 square. Again, a finite number. Likewise, if I add some additional number here, it doesn't make any difference to the behavior. So behavior of an infinite series doesn't change if you remove first finite number of terms, or also if you add some finite number of new terms, then behavior doesn't change. Addition or removal of a finite number of terms in an infinite series does not change its behavior. Of course, it can change the point of convergence, but not the behavior. Likewise, if you are given two different series, suppose this converges to L1, this converges to L2, so this series summation an plus bn converges to L1 plus L2. It's very easy to verify, okay? So sum of two convergent series is convergent, difference is convergent, constant multiple is convergent. Can verify these things. Now, behavior of geometric series. Already know, formally I'm writing here. What is geometric series? A series of this form. What is its behavior? It converges to A over 1 minus R if mod R is less than 1, otherwise it diverges. Okay? You know, it's the sum of first n terms, A into 1 minus R power n over 1 minus R. So as n tends to infinity, this converges to 0 only for this condition. That's why you get this sum. For all other values of R, it is not convergent, means it is divergent. Remember this, you can directly use this result in the problems. Okay? Now, let us learn some tests for behavior of infinite series. In fact, we will deal with positive term infinite series. Positive term infinite series means a series in which all the terms are positive. Okay? Before this, if this infinite series is given to you, what can you say about the limit of nth term, this an, in case the series is convergent? Suppose this series converges to L. What is the limit of nth term? Nth term can be written as Sn minus 1. Am I right? Sum of first n terms minus sum of first n minus 1 terms. Because we are saying that the series converges to L, it means Sn goes to L, Sn minus 1 also goes to L. So this goes to 0. So remember that if a series is convergent, limit of its nth term goes to 0. This is necessary condition for convergence. If it is non-zero, then certainly you can say the series is not convergent, it's divergent. So we have a test, first test, test of divergence. What is it? If for the given infinite series, you find that limit of nth term is non-zero, you can directly say the series is divergent. But remember that if it is zero, you cannot say it's convergent. Other way around, it's not true. It is only test of divergence, not test of convergence. Okay. So if limit of nth term you find in some series non-zero, you can directly say it's divergent. But if limit turns out zero, you cannot conclude anything. I will give you some example later on. Okay. So it's test of divergence only. See this example. Suppose you are given some very complicated looking series. If you are asked to test its behavior, what will you do? Will you find SN? Because that is the original way to do it. No, if you find SN, you will never find it. Okay, so don't try that. Think about this. What is the nth term here? This is the nth term. What is its limit as n tends to infinity? Can you tell me? Limit of this whole expression as n tends to infinity is 1, isn't it? Non-zero? As n tends to infinity, limit of this is 1, which is non-zero. So by test of divergence, you can directly say it's a divergent series. Alright, now let's move to the next test. That is integral test or Cauchy integral test. Integral test, simply integral test or Cauchy integral test. What is it? If n is a function of n, which is non-negative, decreasing for all n, continuous as well, of course, such that an is greater than or equal to an plus 1, means it's decreasing. Okay, so I'm saying that an is a continuous, non-negative, and decreasing function for all n, then behavior of this series and behavior of this sequence 1 to n a x, you can write a x, okay, because in integral we usually write the variable x. Behavior of this sequence and behavior of this series are same, means both converge or diverge together. But what is it? Behavior of the sequence means what? Limit of in? What is that? This integral 1 to infinity ax dx. So if you see that an is a decreasing function of n, you can try this test. It's very easy to apply, just you need to solve this integral. If you get a finite answer of this integral, it means this integral is convergent, or you can say the sequence is convergent, and consequently the series is also convergent because of the integral test. Okay, got it? Let's see a problem. Suppose you are given this series summation 1 over n power p, where p is positive. N goes from 1 to infinity. Even if I don't write it, you should understand n goes from 1 to infinity. So, if p is positive, it is decreasing or not? Yes, you can write this condition. After that, What is this integral here? 1 to infinity, 1 over x power p. 1 to infinity, 1 over x power p dx. Let's solve it. What is this integral? X power 1 minus p over 1 minus p, right? Limits of x are from 1 to infinity. Now, it depends on p when you apply infinity here. It depends on p. So when we get something finite, the p is actually depends on p. If p is greater than 1, say p is greater than 1, then it goes to 0. For the upper limit and for lower limit, you get minus 1 over 1 minus p. Something finite. So in this case, you can say that this integral is convergent, hence the series is convergent. What if p is less than 1? This goes to infinity. This thing goes to infinity. Because if p is less than 1, x has negative power. So as p goes to infinity, below is minus, so you can say it goes to minus infinity. In any case, it is not a finite number. So divergent. P equal to 1, then this is not the integral. This is the case that we are dealing when p is not equal to 1. If p equal to 1, you have to solve this integral separately. What is it? It is ln x, isn't it? But limit of this from 1 to infinity goes to infinity, so it is divergent. So conclusion is that this series is convergent when p is greater than 1, else it is divergent. Very important result. Also, if p is less than or equal to 0, what is the behavior of this? Can you think and tell me? If p is less than or equal to 1, what is the behavior of this series? Not less than or equal to 0, I'm talking, because greater than 0, we have already determined. If p is 0, it is 1 only. Kn is 1 in case p is 0. So its limit is 1 as n tends to infinity. What does it mean? By test of divergence, it is divergent because it is non-zero. P is less than 0, in that case, what is the limit of an? It goes to infinity. P is less than 0, it goes to the numerator and you apply n going to, it goes to infinity. Again, it is non-zero. So, it is divergent. It means in the entire range of P, this series converges only when p is greater than 1. Remember this. This is a very important series. We call it p series and sometimes we call it p test. So what is the advantage of this? Suppose you are given this series. You can say that it is divergent by p series test. Here p is 1. This converges only for p greater than 1. In this case, p is 1. So it diverges. What if p is 2? Converges, because p is 2 greater than 1, it converges. But notice one thing, in both cases an is going to 0. I was telling one point during the test of divergence, if limit of nth term goes to 0, you cannot decide the behavior. Only when it is non-zero, then you can decide, you can apply the test of divergence. Okay? You see, limit of nth term going to 0 in this case as well as this case. But one is divergent, other is convergent. So never conclude anything from this. If you are getting limit of nth term of the infinite series 0, you cannot say anything. Many students write it convergent after seeing this only, but you can see these examples. This is not true. Of course, if it is non-zero, then you can say by test of divergence that the series is divergent. All right, so integral test, you just need to see that the nth term is a decreasing function of n. Okay, then you can apply this test provided you are able to integrate, because that is another constant. So not all the problems you can do by this, only class of problems can be done. Next is comparison test. Comparison test is also useful in some problems. What is it? Summation A is given series, and suppose summation A, summation Bn is another series that you have to think from your side, okay? Such that An is less than equal to Bn. Suppose this relation holds between the nth terms for all n or after finite number of terms, okay? Because addition or removal of a finite number of terms in the series doesn't change its behavior. So summation n is given series, summation bn is another series from your side, and you are able to establish this relation. Then, if this series converges, then this also converges. It's very logical. Bigger series is convergent, its sum is finite. Its sum is also finite. Okay, it's understandable. Opposite situation, an is greater than or equal to bn, and the summation bn is divergent, say. Summation bn is divergent. Then summation a is also divergent. Because in this case, this an is bigger than bn. So you understand this also. There is another form of limit comparison test, which is useful. Another form of comparison test, which we call limit comparison test. This is called direct comparison test, DCT in shortcut. Direct comparison test, this is limit comparison test. In this case, you divide an by bn, see what is the limit. If limit is finite and non-zero, then summation an and summation bn both have same behavior. Both are convergent or both are divergent. What if it is zero? If L is zero, then only one side you can decide. Convergence of summation Bn implies convergence of summation An. And if L is infinity, then divergence of summation Bn implies divergence of summation An. Let's the only issue with this test is that you have to think summation bn from your side. Okay, so it depends on the problem. See this infinite series. Why I'm not choosing n equal to 1 here? You know log 1 is 0. Okay, it starts from 2. No problem. So, what is the behavior of the series? You know this inequality. Logarithm of a natural number is always less than or equal to the natural number. Right? Greater than or equal to 2, you can say this thing, isn't it? 1 over log n is greater than or equal to 1 over n. Am I right? In fact, even you need not to write equality, because this is always less than. 1 over log n is greater than 1 over n. Its behavior you already know. This is your an. This is bn. Say this is bn. Summation bn behavior you already know. It is p series with p equal to 1. So it is divergent. So by comparison test, If smaller series is divergent, bigger series is also divergent. So this is divergent series. In this case, if you are able to think this inequality, you can apply this. Otherwise, you have to think something else. Now see this one, the limit comparison. Example, say you are given n square over n power 4 plus 1. Again, depending on the problem, you have to think what should you choose, bn. Here an is n square over n power 4 plus 1. I can write it 1 over n square into 1 plus 1 over n power 4, correct? Let us choose bn equal to 1 over n square. I'm seeing from this, because if I divide this by 1 over n square, then what do I get? 1 over 1 plus 1 over n power 4, and this goes to 1 as n tends to infinity. So I'm seeing it, limit is finite and non-zero. So I can apply limit comparison test, that both the series summation and summation bn have same behavior. Behavior of bn you already know. It is p series with p equal to 2, that is greater than 1. So it is convergent. Hence it is also convergent. Okay, so this way you have to do some manipulation. You have to think some bn such that you can find this limit n over bn finite and non-zero. Or there are two more results in limit comparison. You need to set one of those three, okay? After that only you can decide the behavior. So you can do more problems from the lecture notes. But you got the idea, right? After comparison test, we have a very important test called ratio test. If summation n is a positive term series, then find the limit n over n plus 1. Take the ratio of nth term to nth term. If this limit is greater than 1, then the series is convergent. This series is convergent. I can write here is convergent if this limit is greater than 1. Divergent if this limit is less than 1. If this limit is equal to 1, the test fails. Very simple to remember. Take the limit of n over n plus 1. If that limit is greater than 1, this series is convergent. Less than 1, divergent. Equal to 1, we cannot say anything. We cannot apply ratio test. Let's see a problem on ratio test. Say, the series is n factorial over n power n. So what is n over n plus 1 here? Simplify this. It is n factorial over n power n into n plus 1 whole power n plus 1 over n plus 1 factorial. Am I right? Change n to n plus 1 in this expression for an plus 1. After division, you get this thing. Now, simplify it further. What do you get? It is n plus 1 into n factorial. N factorial is cancelled. N plus 1 is also cancelled. N plus 1 power n over n power n. That you can write 1 over 1 plus 1 over n whole power n. What is the limit of this as n tends to infinity? Is a standard limit. Let's see. It goes to e as n tends to infinity. Exponential number. Let me remind you the standard formula. N tends to infinity, 1 plus x over n whole power n. This limit is e power x. Here x is 1. So e is greater than 1 or less than 1? It's greater than 1. 2 point something. Greater than 1. So what can you conclude about the series from ratio test? It's convergent. It's convergent. Okay. If you are given this series, summation n only, what is an here? N. An over n plus 1. N over n plus 1. What is the limit? 1. 1. You cannot apply the test now. So you cannot decide the behavior of the series using ratio test. Okay. You have to think something here. Though you already know this series is divergent, but ratio test cannot be applied here. So the problems where specifically factorial is there, you should apply ratio test, because you can deal with factorial only by cancelling it in the ratio. Okay. You can also deal with this kind of series using ratio test. Summation, say 1, 3, 5 and so on up to 2n minus 1, 2, 5, 8 and so on to 3n minus 1. If you write this series in expanded form, you know what are the terms? 1 by 2 plus 1 into 3 over 2 into 5. Plus 1 into 3 into 5 over 2 into 5 into 8 and so on. Okay. So what's happening in each term? One extra factor is coming in the numerator as well as denominator as per this rule. So this kind of series behavior can be tested using ratio test. Why? Because in this case, this is your an, the whole expression. What is an plus 1? 1, 3, 5 and so on. One extra factor, change n to n plus 1. What do you get? 2n plus 1? 2, 5, 8 and so on. 3n minus 1. Change n to n plus 1 means 3n plus 2, correct? So now if you divide this an by n plus 1, what do you get? This whole portion is cancelled. Just reciprocal of this, 3n plus 2 over 2n plus 1. This goes to 3 over 2 as n tends to infinity, greater than 1. So this series is convergent. Okay, so this kind of series you can deal only with ratio test. Okay, so likewise you can do more problems on ratio test. Let's see the next test, that is Cauchy root test or simply root test. What is it? Again, summation n is a positive term series. This is convergent if limit of the nth root of an. In fact, you should write it like this, okay, properly, but it's fine if you, because this means there are n roots. It means only the positive nth root. Okay. So if limit of this is less than 1, the series is convergent. If limit of the nth root of an is greater than 1, divergent. And again, if it is equal to 1, the test fails. You cannot apply the test. You understand why the name root test? Because you are taking nth root of the nth term. In some problems, it is very useful. Let's see. Suppose you are given the series 1 over n power n. Then what is n here? 1 over n power n? That means n power 1 over n is 1 over n. Its limit is 0 as n tends to infinity. This is less than 1. So by ratio test, this series is convergent. Correct? So whenever you see n in the power of n somewhere, and you feel that by taking nth root you can find the limit, different from 1 of course, then you can use this root test. So in some problems it is very useful. Okay. Also see this problem where n depends on some unknown constant x. One plus one over n whole power n. So what is n here? This whole expression is n. You are saying n in the powers, so let's take nth root. What do we get? 1 plus 1 over n into x. This goes to x as n tends to infinity. That means the behavior of this series depends on x. It's clear from here, it depends on x. From root test, what can you say? If this x is less than 1, convergent, the series is convergent. Greater than 1, divergent. The series is divergent because of the root test. If equal to 1, say x is equal to 1, then you cannot decide using root test. You have to consider that case separately. What is the case when x is 1? It is 1 plus 1 over n whole power n. The particular case x equal to 1. So what is the behavior of this series? See nth term. Nth term. This nth term only goes to e, isn't it? As n tends to infinity. This is standard limit I told you earlier. This is 1, 0. So you can say by test of divergence that this series is divergent. Am I right or not? So now you can say the behavior of the series in the full range of x. It is convergent for x less than 1 and divergent for x greater than or equal to 1. Okay, so this way you can deal problems involving some unknown constant x. You can also find such problems in ratio test, okay? Alright, so hope you understood all these concepts, what I have discussed, sequences, and some basic tests for testing the behavior of positive term infinite series. So we need one more lecture to finish this chapter, okay? So remaining topics I will discuss in the next lecture. Thank you.